The output of this, there is a generator which generates something called as the DFAs for this program. So basically, we know the DFA is a graph, right? So the graph contains arcs. So the arcs, these are the arcs, and the arcs are later managed into states, and the states is used to construct the DFAs. So the arcs are then converted into state. So a state is like a node in the DFA. So it tells what are the incoming arcs and what are the outgoing arcs. And from this state, an DFA is constructed. So this is the DFA of the Python. So it contains 85 possible ways, and the DFA has 85 states. And so let's see the structure of a DFA. So a DFA has a name, and what are the number of states, and an array of the possible states. So that's what we see here. It's the array of the possible states. So you see here, right? You see single input, file input, eval input. It's exactly mapped to what is there in the grammar. Single input, file input, eval input. So it maps. So basically, if you write off something from the interpreter, it will be taken as a single input. So how that is parsed is present in a file called parse-tok. This is the function that parses all the tokens. It's called parse-tok. It's a very complicated function. I have not been able to understand it completely myself. So it goes through an infinite loop and goes through your program and gets token by token. And then it goes through your DFA. It tries to add it to the parse tree. So this is the function. This is the function that adds the. So this is the function that adds the token to the parse tree. So basically, if you have a is equal to 100, first this state of this DFA will be a single input, and then it will get converted into an assignment statement. The assignment statement will get further breaked up into a variable a, then it will get into the token equal to, and then is equal to 10. So each of this will be emitted as a token, and it will be added back to the parse tree. So this is what is the parse tree. This node here is the pointer to the parse tree. So do you want me to explain further how parse trees are constructed and everything? Or we can go directly into the doubts that you might have. I think that's better. This is a very dry subject. It's like law. You cannot break it. So we can take up any specific questions that you might have about how they work. There were a lot of questions, actually. Yeah.
I mean, this kind of requires a lot of back knowledge because it depends on the talk he gave last time.
Okay, I will try my best.
Okay. When you reassign, when you initialize a variable with an integer, when you initialize another variable with the same integer, so there's a limit which has Python has this limit saying that if it is between -5 to 256, it points to the same memory location.
Okay.
And so it points to the same memory location because it handles something called as the pybit. I've forgotten where it stores it here. I've reached to that point.
So your question is, if the value is between 0 and 255, do they all point to the same memory location?
Yeah. They basically point to the same memory location.
Okay, you want to check that in the source code?
Yeah, if you can go through that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
So now my question is that if you can fire up an interpreter or if you can write it in a file. So if I initialize a value, say a is 1000, b is 1000 inside a function and compare the IDs of both, and it says that it is pointing to the same location. So according to this, it should not be the point.
Is it doing like that in your function?
Yeah.
Okay.
If it is inside a function.
So you want to check if it's optimizing something?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've reached till this particular point.
PyCode optimize is the function that performs, it's the master function for all optimizations. So if anything is happening, it should happen here. Okay. So it's most probably load const. Can we take this offline?
Yeah, sure.
Because I can show it through the interpreter. Yeah. Because if I can't debug, I'm really not sure what's happening here. Okay. But I don't see anywhere something like that is happening. Wait, let's interpret it once and then try it. Any other questions? But you get an idea where to look for. So if that might be an optimization. But in this optimization for load constant, where a is equal to something, b is equal to something, I don't see anything like that happening. So it might be somewhere else also in the code flow. Yeah.
So, but your question was basically, if you fire it up from a function,
yes,
even if it is beyond 255,
yes,
it is still getting interned.
Yes. Yes. And it points to the same location. He mentioned about scopes being a possibility, that it is inside a function, so maybe it is optimizing in that way.
Yeah.
If I have it as a separate global one, I haven't tried that yet.
So I doubt they do something like that, because I think the bytecode that's generated is the same. So they load a constant, put it into a variable. So I've seen the source code for the optimization, but nowhere I have seen if it's within a function and there is a load const, do something. I have not seen anything like that. Basically, this function almost does nothing. They exclaim it themselves. If you want to write good Python code, it all depends on you. So it doesn't depend on how the compiler optimizes. Then I've asked this question several times, and I've been thrashed for asking that question also. So, yeah, any other questions? Mm. So you want to know how the parse tree is converted into the source code?
Huh.
Okay. After your parser is run, it moves into something called as an AST. So AST is an abstract syntax tree. So this is the, if you want to go me to go into this function, we can go it. But if you want me to just abstract and say it generates the AST from the file, I can do that much and stop it. So do you know what an abstract syntax tree is? So you know that. So I will not go into this function. Let's just assume it's a black box. You give it a file input, it gives you back the AST for that particular. So here is the code object. So it has two operations. One, it generates a symbol table using pySymbolTable_build, and then it calls the compiler module. So the compiler module. So there is different pathways for whether you are doing it as a module or whether you are doing it as a interactive session. So if you are doing it as an interactive session, it directly generates the bytecode. So don't get worried about this. It just is going through the AST syntax tree and it's calling a particular macro. So in this case, it is calling compiler_visit, and when you know #, it means it is appending something to it, right? So that so the type is equal to statement. So it will call compiler_visit_stmt. So this is the function that will be called. So if it's of a so let's take the simplest assignment statement. Okay. So it has two, it has a value and it has the targets where it has to be assigned. So it simply calls add operation to the, so C is your bytecode object, and adds an opcode to that. So this is the pointer that contains all instruction codes. The offset is what you have passed to it. It generates an instruction to it, adds the opcode to that instruction. If it has an argument, it makes it, if it has an argument, it will make it 1. And it will also set the line number so that you can debug it later. So this is how the, it goes instruction by instruction from the abstract syntax tree, goes iterates through it, and for every instruction, it generates an opcode. So this is how it's done. So it's there in my book also, you can explore it further. This I have explained only for statement, but there is a lot more different use cases in which this is done.
So Python, does it treat lambda functions as well as normal functions differently underneath, or
same? Internally they are the same file, py function object. It's just a syntactical sugar. That's
it. Breaking down into multiple methods, does it impact performance?
No.
No.
But you should always keep a tab of how many imports you do, because that's going to import.
Imports will impact.
Yeah.
But,
Not very great amount of performance. These code objects are very small in memory. Not very high in memory.
Not in the memory wise, performance wise.
No. But if you make unnecessary functions, yes it will. But if you really need a function and you want to make it into a function, you should go ahead and do it. And you should not make like what can be done as a one function shouldn't be made as four or five functions, because it's going to make it very modular. It's not required. But if you have a real use case and say I'm going to reuse this part again and again, then we should as well go ahead and make a function and not think about the impact that will have.
Sometimes we break functions to, that core function could be easily tested.
Mm.
So test that the whole program will be tested very properly.
That's I understand that the adoption, like you need to make it as small as possible and have as many unit test cases as possible. But I'm not sure there. Because we don't use that methodology. I don't use that methodology.
No, I mean,
because in our
impact is,
performance impact, and I don't
there,
think that
there is a
performance
impact. There is going to be some form of performance impact, because what you're going to do is you're going to be pushing something on top of a stack and then you're going to be popping it out and all that. So there is going to be some form of impact which is extremely negligible.
Yeah. So if you should make as many functions as possible. Whenever you feel that this part of code is reusable, even in Python, I think we should go ahead and try to make it into a function.
I believe that you should make more functions, but it all depends upon the use case.
Usually we restrict like not more than 20 lines in a function.
Yeah.
No, more than
that's
20 lines is very
I also follow the same school of thought.
Yes.
No 7 ideas, more than 7 ideas is not good enough.
I think those things depend on the methodology. When I was working on a project in Python, there were some requirements like this, that a function should be like this, and it shouldn't be so more than so many characters in a line. So these are company-specific ideologies, but from my perspective, they will not have a large impact. I think you should go out to make as many functions as possible. Yeah.
If it's a function which is called like a million times or something,
it's okay. Don't call it recursively. That's it. Don't call a million function million times to call each of them recursing internally.
That
be a million into a million.
Recursion,
I don't think any compiler in the world can handle that.
In Python, they have a recursion breaker, right? It will, if you go recursively, it breaks after some
time. It knows when to break.
It's like 50 iterations or something like that.
It should be more.
No, because I have observed this, like I write
stack. How much stack?
This actually I use these recursion methods very, very often.
Mm.
It automatically breaks if the recursion is too deep.
Yeah.
I didn't find the number.
I think that they'll be there in the interpreter loop somewhere. They will know that it's the same function that's getting caught.
They have a sys variable, sys dot get recursion limit. It has around 1000. You can modify it to 10,000 or whatever.
Yeah.
So we actually have the last speaker is coming.
Oh,
and
nice.